Hi everyone. I am out here in San Jose enjoying Fanime. In case you don't know, that's like cosplay and anime fans and comic books and all kinds of fun geeky stuff. Usually I dress up, but the best thing I'm gonna do is this dress today. So what we really have to address is everyday issues within our system. And I really realized how much I needed to talk about this because there have been several comments, and one from a person who even knew me, who, you know, like it's only a very small few people, mind you, but he pretty much was like, I was attacking the woman and I was racist for asking her, are you sure this isn't about two black men trying to barbecue and saying that she's white, you know, which the dispatch had asked for her race. So yes, her race did matter. But the reason why this topic is so important is that it is the everyday silencing in society that makes the system strong. And I'm talking about the system of racism, the system of, you know, like even police violence. You know, they say the blue line is strong. There's a silent code within the police force that has been around for a long time, and that is why that continues. So there's also a silent code among people who prefer to be in white circles or only want it to, their system to be in a certain way, and maybe they don't even realize that they are playing into this system of racism, but they are. So there's a code of silence, and that's what I wanted to talk about. And the best way for us to fight that, for one, I heard a lot of comments from white people who said, I'm white and I'm so ashamed and I hope she doesn't represent us. And, you know, I totally understand that. It's like MS-13 shouldn't represent all South American and Mexicans that are in America or even through everywhere else. Like, that's not an equal representation. Black on black crime, as they call it in Chicago, is not an equal representation of, you know, black people across America. We are all different people, and it is not our skin color or where we are coming from that makes us who we are. Like, some of that defines us as far as culture, but culture itself is not bad. Just like religion itself is not bad. It is that when people come in and they infiltrate these social systems for their own corrupt reasons to, you know, manipulate and control. And the best way to manipulate and control people is to silence them, to pretend like the problem doesn't exist, and to pretend like you don't hear, you know, it's just like the see no evil, hear no evil, speak no evil. That's what we're going through. That is what keeps a strong system of racism. And being told over and over again recently that I am racist for talking about racism is fucking ridiculous. Like, I'm just like, okay, am I supposed to be hurt about that? Or am I supposed to feel like that's a reflection on me? I don't even care if people don't like me. It's not new. I was picked on as a young girl because I was different. I'm always different, you know? I was never, you know, thin. I'm just like a bit awkward. I'm an artist, you know? I don't care. At this point, you could call me fat, you know, it's not like the millionth time that I have heard that before. So creative, right? You know, but I'm sure somebody will, because I've heard it a million times. And it doesn't really matter. What matters at the end of this all is if you feel like it's a shameful act and you don't want it to reflect on you in this society, it's because we need to change the society itself. Our American society is built on a system of racism and classism and, you know, this imperialistic capitalism, you know, it just goes on and on and on. And it doesn't mean that that's the defining point of our society, because there have been a lot of people that fought to change all that. And we have to honor the people who have died before us to fight for that. There's a lot of people that died to make the civil rights movement happen. That, you know, there's a lot of people that pushed for women to be able to vote. I was born in 1977, okay? My mom wasn't even able to get her own credit card back then. Okay, that's not even that long ago if you think about it. So, you know, we are still evolving as a society, and I think we have done better, but it's very easy for us to slip back. And that's what I was witnessing, you know, as I have seen rallies, and then as I've seen this woman and the way she was behaving with my husband. My husband has not had as many problems as he's had over the last few years. It's like amplified. You know, there's just this last clutch of the, you know, white supremacy trying to grab hold and still breathe and have power. And you know how it breathes and has power is when people continue with that code of silence. So when they say don't talk about racism unless it's a racial slur, that is somebody who's protecting racism. Because racial slurs do not make, you don't have to have a racial slur or something very visual in order to know that there is something wrong with our society. Looking at this woman who was in the video, the Barbecue Becky video, right? Everybody said, I mean, not everybody, but a lot of people said she probably was mentally ill. Well, guess what? Her mental illness had to do with the system that she believed in herself. She believed she had the authority. She is not the only one who believes this. So yes, there are a lot of mentally ill people out there. What are you gonna do about it? Yes, there are people that are sitting there saying that I shouldn't have done things the way I did, but they have no solutions. And I can't be polite when somebody is trying to have my husband arrested for barbecuing. Like, I was actually pretty polite, if you think about it, but they still think that I shouldn't have said something. I should have stand by. They want me to be silenced. And you know what? I don't care. I'm not going to be silenced, and neither should you. So if you are, especially if you're a white person who is just fed up with this and, you know, like you're embarrassed and you don't want it to reflect on you, we can't have this perfect society where everybody's perfect, but we can change this current system that is like an illness. It's like a cancer that has infected our society. And it's trying to take over everybody. And it's also making them mentally ill. And I think we can identify with that every time we see these kind of actions happening. It's like, is that person mentally ill? Well, yeah, they probably are, but it has larger reasoning to it that has to do with our society giving them this idea that it's perfectly okay to behave like this to other people. So I wanted to give it a good example of this. I'm going to tell you guys a story. When I was 16, this was like around 93, 94, I had grown up in the suburbs of Pacifica, and I was tired of the school I was in. I didn't understand what was the point of history if all we learned about was generals and, you know, dates and all this kind of stuff. I was like, what am I learning here? I'm not learning anything. I don't feel like this is even telling me the full truth of everything. I want to know the full truth. So when I was in that school, I would learn about the colonies. What I did was I transferred to another school called Westmore High School in Daly City. And this school, you know, it had like black students, it had South American and Mexican and Filipino and Chinese and Samoan. So there were very few white people. I was tested as soon as I got in there. So, you know, that can be a little awkward if you're the one person that is, you know, white and you're not used to a different setting. But it wasn't hard. I mean, it was a Samoan girl who came up to me and she was like, I'll show you around the school. And she took me to lunch. During lunch, she took me to this room at the end of the hall. It was like this dark room. She opens the door. It was like, I don't know, it was like a closet, like a walk-in size closet. And there was like, I don't know, maybe six white people just hiding out in this closet eating like this in chairs with each other. And seeing how diverse the school was and there wasn't a lot of white people, I was like, is this where all the white people are? I don't understand this. And she said, these are your friends? And I said, no, I'm not hiding in the closet. And she laughed. I mean, we said this right in front of them too. So they just kind of looked at me like I betrayed them. And then she closed the door. She's like, all right, you're cool. And then she started introducing me to other people. And I started to get to know all the different people in the school, and people treated me the same as they treated everybody else. So I didn't have a problem, you know, going through that school. And it taught me a lot when I was able to actually listen to different people's backgrounds and stories and what they went through, I started to be able to understand where they were coming from. But what was most interesting about this situation was in my history class. And the teacher was like, all right, we're gonna talk about colonization. And everybody looked at me. And I was like, what's that? I was like, what am I getting into? But I was kind of excited. I was like, I finally get to learn about real world history, because I'm kind of tired of only hearing about the Romans and the French Revolution and what the British did. You know, like, we only learned about European history. We didn't really learn about anything else. Oh, well, we learned about colonization and how America had involvement and, you know, the Philippines and the territories. And after we learned all that, everybody looked at me and they were like, what do you think? And I was like, you know, like, I know I was just embarrassed. Like, I probably turned beet red. And I was like, you know, I really didn't know what to say. But I really did feel embarrassed and horrified. So that's pretty much all I said, was I was like, I'm embarrassed and horrified because I've never known any of this. They don't teach this in the classes in the school that I went to. And everybody was like, well, good, that's the first step. And that is the first step. I mean, you don't have to be, what I have learned is that, you know, even though there's a system of white supremacy and there are people that act out and it is embarrassing, you don't have to feel like it's a reflection on you. The worst thing you could do is start making it about you. And that was what somebody had said to me recently, was, you know, well, a group of black guys, they attacked me and bullied me. And I was like, well, probably because of the way you're talking, like, you're making everything about yourself. You know, if somebody is saying this is my experience, and there are so many people saying this, like the whole world is screaming this is my experience, and instead you make it about yourself, they're not gonna like you, because they realize that you only care about you. So, you know, I appreciate and love all the white people that are like, you know what, I don't want this anymore and I'm gonna fight for it. And they already understand this. They already hang out with different people. I've just witnessed so much change over the last few decades in that. But for those who don't know what to do, it's okay. Because we weren't taught the right things. And it's time that we learn, and it's time we educate ourselves. And so if you find the right information, you will start to understand, and you don't have to feel like it's a reflection on you. You didn't create the system. Even if it was your grandfather who helped, that wasn't you. You can change the system still. You can change history. No, you can't change history. Scratch that. You could change the future. But, you know, there's nothing to be ashamed of if you are the one who is changing what has been going on. But what solidifies and continues the system of racism is this code of silence, of shaming people from speaking out, and of not going and seeking the true education. Silence is a system of control. Silence, trying to pretending like you don't hear, pretending like you don't see, and being told you can't speak, and if you are, you will be shamed, you will be embarrassed, all this kind of stuff. This stuff is hidden. They will be very careful not to do racial slurs or not to look like they're racist, but it doesn't mean that the system isn't there and they aren't attempting to oppress groups of people. I mean, we see it happening all the time, and I find it odd that anybody would say that they're colorblind or racism doesn't exist in the day when we have Trump in office. It's like, well, you're the one that is, yeah, you're definitely blind, and you're definitely not listening, and you're probably actually speaking too much, but not about anything that makes any kind of sense. And then, of course, block the trolls. So anyways, I hope you all have a fun Memorial weekend barbecue and have fun. And I'll see y'all later. If you have any topics you want me to talk about, or, you know, just send them in the comments below, and I'll keep going. Peace.